welcome to the Dean Show. Today in the studio, back by popular demand, he's been known now, giving a great lecture on the Dean Show, only on the Dean Show, Islam in the Bible. You can view it at the website, thedeanshow.com. He's back again here in the Dean Show studio. Without further delay, let's bring out our special guest, Joshua Evans.
Assalamualaikum.
Waalaikumsalam, brother. How are you?
Alhamdulillah. How are you?
Alright, be to God. We see that last time you were with us, you put on some really great material, and it really got to be viewed by a lot of people worldwide. And we want to now, we're glad that you're back with us again. We want to have you talk about this up-and-coming show that you're doing called The True Gospel of Jesus.
Yes, this time we're going to do a show based on what was the true gospel message of Jesus Christ. What did he really talk about? You know, we hear that the gospel of Jesus was this, the preachers say this, you know, the pastors say this, but I want to go into the Bible. This is what I did when I wanted to find the truth about God, is I went into the Bible and said, okay, if I follow Jesus, what did he really say? What did he really preach?
That's what you're going to be talking about this week on the Dean Show. For those of you who don't know who Joshua Evans is, he's a former Christian youth minister. Now, we have his interview on his section on the Dean Show, along with other shows that he's done. You can view this anytime. Just log on, check it out. And we're going to be adding these new shows along with this one to his section on the Dean Show. So tell us a little more. So you're going to be talking about the true gospel of Jesus?
The true gospel of Jesus.
Real quickly, give us a glimpse how you came to Islam.
I came to Islam back in 1998 after an in-depth search of the Bible. I was trying to become a Bible scholar. I really wanted to use the Bible, since it was, to a Christian, the way to live your life. So I wanted to know more about this book. I wanted to know everything about it. So as I searched more, I began to realize that there was some things wrong with it, that it was not the true word of God as most people claim. So I began an in-depth search that if this is not, then where does the true word of God lie? What is the true way of life that God wants me to live? So I searched almost every religion that you can think of that is known on the face of the planet, until I finally, you know, by the grace of God, came in contact with Islam. And when I came in contact with Islam and read the Quran, the holy book that is revered by Muslims, that was revealed to Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, then I saw that the true gospel message of Jesus Christ and this Quran were one and the same. They were one and the same. Islam and what the Bible really said at its original state were one and the same. So a long story made very short, this is how I accepted Islam.
If you want to see the complete interview on how he came to Islam, more detail, like I said, on his section on the Dean Show, we have this interview with Joshua Evans, Yusha, how he came to Islam, one man's tale. Now we're going to move on. We have a few questions for you. Tell us, now that you're a Muslim, and a Muslim is one who submits himself willingly to what?
To the will of God.
Okay, nothing created but to the creator of the heavens and the earth.
Creator.
Very simple. And he does Islam, which means?
He submits. He submits himself entirely. His entire life becomes a life that is lived according to the will and the law of God.
Okay, so you're going to hear Muslim, which is one who does Islam, which is an action, it's a verb, it's to submit, surrender, with obedience sincerely to the will of the creator of the heavens and the earth, worshiping him alone, correct?
Yes.
So you're going to hear this word Islam, Muslim. You're going to hear the word Allah. We're going to use Allah, which means?
Allah means the God. It is the proper noun for God.
Yes.
It is the name that was not only used by Muslims, it is used by Arab Christians. If you open a Bible in Arabic, the first word in the fourth word in the book is Allah, that God created the heaven and earth in 7 days. This was the word that was used by the Jews. This was a word that was used by Jesus Christ in his own language. He said Allah. This was the word for God in Aramaic, which is the language Jesus spoke. And in Judaism, it's Eloha. All is the same. All of it just means that the one true God, that is all your actions, directions, and worship should be focused towards this one God, the creator of the heavens and the earth,
so
and no one else.
In Aramaic, Jesus, peace be upon him, would say Allaha.
Allaha.
And we say Allah.
We say Allah.
That's the God we call upon.
Yes.
Yeah.
And Jesus, when he said God, he said Allaha.
Exactly. So now, tell us, now that you're Muslim, you probably have mixed reactions from people. Tell us, why do you think, you know, certain people bash Islam? And tell us your experience in dealing with different people who are Christian or who have heard your story.
I think that most people today are very detrimental towards Islam and bashing Islam because it's somewhat the status quo of the day. You know, it's what you hear, you know, it's what's being talked about the most. You know, all of people's anger now is being, of the world in general, is being misplaced on Muslims. You know, we're getting the brunt of the issues, which is incorrect, but it's not anything new. This has happened, you know, time and time again. It happened to the Japanese in the World War II era. You know, it happened to all of those who claimed to follow communism during the Cold Wars. You know, it happened to, you know, the Indians. It happened to the African Americans. You know, we're just the next in line. So what we have to do is follow in the footsteps of those who came before us in combating it with the truth. Getting out there, being outspoken, you know, saying what Islam really is, presenting in a true fashion, which we are trying to do right now. This is our purpose, so that people can see the truth and make their own decisions.
And just to point out that, if I'm correct, tell me that it is not a Muslim's job to try to convert anybody. It's not our job to try to convert people to Islam. It's simply to convey the clear message.
Yes.
And what is that message?
That message is that we should submit ourselves completely and entirely to the will of the Creator and follow His law.
That's a Muslim's job, is just to convey this message, just to deliver the message.
That's it.
That God is one, worship Him alone. The Quran is the verbatim word of God.
That's it.
And now Muhammad is the last and final messenger in a line of messengers.
Yes.
And now it's up to you. If you want to submit to God, if you don't, you'll be accountable. There's a day of judgment, and at the end you'll be rewarded according to your actions, or you'll be punished.
Yes.
It's very simple.
That's it.
Okay, so just to point that out, it's not our job. We're not trying to convert nobody. We're just trying to educate and clear a lot of the misconceptions and the ignorance that's out there, and which leads to many of these things that people do and say. Tell us about people who have some knowledge. How do you deal with people that come out and they claim to have some knowledge about Islam, and it seems like they deliberately try to mislead people? Have you dealt with people like this?
Yes, you actually have. It is becoming a trend of, you know, evangelicals and people of this nature actually going to courses to learn about Islam, which is something that is a very hidden fact now, that they have training courses where they teach people how to know about Muslims, even to a sense of how to become a Muslim outwardly, and then send them to Muslim countries and convert them to Islam. You run into them here, or convert them from Islam to Christianity, and you run into them here, you know, people that claim knowledge of the Bible, even some people that are able to speak the language, they're able to quote the Quran, they're able to do these things, and they go against Islam. The only thing that I can say about them is that their knowledge is not in order to gain knowledge. They have knowledge in order to be detrimental with the knowledge. So those people are not going to have that type of guidance. Those people I usually try not to discourse with, because they're not coming to you in order to learn. They're coming to you in order to be aggressively detrimental towards Islam. They have no purpose of getting guidance. Their heart is somewhat already closed. So with those people, I try to more or less give them a sense that the knowledge that you have, you should first let it sink into your heart. Take it and realize what you have in your own hands before you try to bring it to me. You know, which I did, as trying to take the Bible to Christians. I first internalize it and see what does it mean to me. And then I'll take it to them, rather than just learning it word by word and taking it and trying to bash them with it.
Gotcha. Tell us, Joshua Yusha, on the Dean Show. Thank you for coming out again, with us. Next question I have for you is, since you're in the area of dawah, tell us, how do you deal with situations when someone tries to diminish or attacks the Prophet's character, the last and final message of Mecca? How do you deal with these situations?
The way I deal with it, being that I am experienced in the field of dawah, and dawah just means that invite. It's an Arabic word that means to invite someone. You know, that's, which is what you said earlier, that we're inviting. We're not forcing anyone to the religion. We're inviting them, just like you would invite someone to your home. They can accept or reject your invitation. Those people who bash the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, peace be upon him's character, which you find a lot more now, what I try to do or talk to them is tell them the evidence for his character is very clear. Go read it for yourself. Don't read what you've read it from some Orientalist or some, you know, some agnostic or some Harvard scholar, some Oxford scholar. Go read the texts that were preserved from the time when he was on this earth till now. They're preserved. They're there, his life story, his sayings, his teachings, the way he acted, the way he lived, is there for us. Go read them and then make your own decision. So for anyone to have gone and done that and then say something detrimental would to me would be extremely surprising, because even people who are not Muslim who have read the Prophet's life, like Michael Hart, who wrote a book on the 100 most influential people in the world and chose Muhammad, peace be upon him, as number one, you know, even though he wasn't Muslim, you know, all of these things, because it's there and it's pristinely preserved. So I tell them, go read it for yourself. Go read it and then come back and see if you can tell me the same thing. And I most likely promise them that they cannot.
Okay, tell us, what are some of the biggest misconceptions that you think people have about Islam?
I think the main misconception, not only is it the main misconception, but it is the main thing that Muslims should be focused on in clearing, is that people think that we worship another God. They think that Allah is some other God, it's some other deity. So we have to reiterate them over and over that Allah means the God who is the creator of everything that exists. He's the God of the Bible. He was the God of Adam, the God of Moses, the God of Noah, Abraham, Jesus, peace be upon him, all, and the God of Muhammad, peace be upon him. So I think that is the main major misconception. And then also you have a lot of misconceptions about the gender issue in Islam, how women are viewed in Islam and how men treat women in Islam. And I try to explain to the people over and over again that, you know, how Islam liberates women. But it's hard for me to say it coming from a man's perspective, but a lot of times, you know, it's good coming from sisters, like when my wife tells another lady that my veil covering frees me from being subjugated to all of these things that you're subjugated to every day, whistling, people leering at you, people wanting to use you as a sex object, people, you know, lusting over you and wanting to rape you and things like this. It comes better from her. And then I try to explain to them that whatever a Muslim does to a woman that is detrimental is against Islam and not for it. So those are, I think, the two main misconceptions. And that we're always thinking of killing someone. I think that's another main misconception, which is very easily cleared up by the verse in the Quran that whosoever kills one innocent life as though he's killed all of humanity, and whoever saves one innocent life as though he's saved all of humanity. So it's very clear in the book.
It's very simple. If you go to the book, the verbatim word of God, the Quran,
it's there.
You come in with an open heart, you know, an open mind, humble yourself, and just read. Ask God to guide you.
Yes.
And read.
It's there. It's there, unless you have some people that pick and choose verses,
yeah,
and use them and construe the circumstances and things like that. That's not the right concept. If they go and read the book beginning to end, read it. Go to someone who has knowledge of the book and see what it really says. It's very clear in its own statements.
Because if you want to cut and paste,
you can make it say anything.
You can make it say anything.
So I can make the Bible say anything.
Exactly. Yeah. So tell us about this true gospel of Jesus. Go a little bit into it real quickly. Give us some glimpse of it.
What I wanted to do was to go into the Gospels, go into the four books that are written about Jesus' life, go into the red letter words from any Christian who knows what I'm talking about. In the Bible, if you open it in the New Testament, there'll be red letters which are denoting that these are direct quotations of Jesus. Let's go into these words and see what he has to say. What I did was I threw everything else out and only referred to the red letters and said, okay, let me see what Jesus really spoke out of his own mouth. And when you read that, you start to see that it is a very different picture than what Paul said. It is a very different picture than what is taught by Christian theology today. It is a very different picture. And it is a picture that very much coincides with what the Bible says from Genesis all the way through. It's a very, very same message that Jesus said, God is one. I am sent from God. God is greater than I. And therefore, the only way to get to God is by worshiping Him alone. And I am the way to God. I am the prophet sent by God, therefore I am the way, I am the truth of God, and I am the light. I am that which is emanating from God. No one can come to God except through me, because I am the one sent. It's a very clear message. So we go into the Bible and go through all of these verses, and I lay it out there for everyone and tell them that they can take it, dissect it, go research it, go try to disprove it, do whatever they want to with it, and then come back with their own decisions.
You're not discrediting really anybody's character. You're not bashing anybody.
No.
Which you see many people doing about Islam and with Muslims. But
yes,
we're trying to build. And at the end, tell us, once you present this evidence, if the person chooses not to accept this as from the Creator, That's his free choice to do so.
That's their free choice.
We still deal kindly with these with people. We still don't bash them. And
no, that's right. It's their free choice because, as I said, the da'wah means to invite. It is on someone to accept or reject the invitation because only God is the guide. And there's an Arabic word that God describes himself as called al-hadi, which means the guide, the one who controls the heart. I can maybe help you in your mind get over something, but only God can control the heart. Only He can open the heart, and then that person can accept that guidance or reject that guidance. But I am not that source of guidance. Only God is the source. We are only the means. God is the source of guidance. We as Muslims are the means. We are the ones who are inviting to God.
Tell us, Joshua, before we come to a close, tell us real quickly, if somebody has investigated Islam and he feels that he wants to become a Muslim, tell us these steps, how simple it is, what one needs to do, and give us some advice on how he can facilitate this.
If someone reaches that point where they've studied Islam, they've looked at the shows, and they come to the conclusion that I came to, where I came to a point where I said, okay, this is the way of life that I want to live. This is the correct way of life given by God to humanity. So then I was, in my own heart, I said, okay, what is the next step? You know, and the next step to that is to accept it in your heart. That number one makes you a Muslim. Then there is by a formal way that has been tradition since the time of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, that someone would make a statement called Shahada in Arabic, which just means a statement. You make a statement, which in Arabic, I'm going to say it twice very slow, is Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah, which means that there is no God, there is nothing on this existence that is worthy of worship except Allah, the one true God, and that Muhammad, peace be upon him, is the messenger of God. So it's Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadar Rasulullah, which just means that there's nothing worthy of worship. I am testifying with my mouth, because even the Bible says that the mouth is a profession of what is in the heart. So I'm professing with my mouth that there is nothing worthy of worship except Allah, and Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. After that, what you need to do is find your local mosque or your local masjid. The way I did that was I went to the phone book. You go into the phone book under churches, and there's usually an Islamic section for that, for the mosques. Or you can even call 411 and you get the address and the phone number to your local mosque or your local masjid in your area, and then go there and try to find people. The best time to find them probably will be on a Friday, you know, around noontime. But you most likely nowadays can go to any mosque at any time and get someone, or get a number, get someone you can call, and call them and introduce yourself and say, look, I have accepted this religion of Islam. What do I need to do next? Because then they will help you. There will be locally people there to help you, to put you on the path, such as starting to learn how to pray correctly to the God. You know, starting to learn all of these things that are the next steps in line after becoming Muslim. But the most important part that's really going to enable one to have a right standing before God is that acceptance of that there's no God but the one God, Allah, and then Muhammad is the messenger of Allah.
And what one needs to know, when one does this, when he enters into the fold of Islam, like he said, making it, believing it in your heart, and then testifying it with your tongue, and then following it up with action, that one now has become a Muslim. He has submitted his face, his self, to the Creator of the heavens and earth, not his creation. And now all his past, previous sins are forgiven. He's like a newborn baby.
Yes, they become wiped away. It is as if the day he was born. There's no sins, there's no nothing. Everything, no matter what he has done in his life, even from the worst of the worst of the worst of the worst things, they are forgiven by God.
If he now owes somebody a debt, or he has individually hurt somebody, he should go and reconcile
that. He should go and reconcile if he's hurt someone, you know, if he
owes a debt or something.
He should go and try to repay and seek that forgiveness. But anything that he has personally done, no matter whether he's robbed, no matter whether he's killed, no matter what he's done, if he's worshipped thousands of gods, when he comes to that knowledge of the one true God and accepts it, that contract, that is a contract that they make with God, and the return for that contract is paradise. The contract is that you will take that free will which God gave you, a free will to do whatever you want. You can do whatever you please. You take that free will, give it back to God, and say, okay, now I want to do your will. And then that, in turn, for that small sacrifice, you get a forever paradise.
And now, all your past sins are forgiven, and now from that point you should start establishing the prayer.
Yes,
the five pillars of Islam.
Yeah, you start with the five pillars establishing the
prayer.
Which
is the prayer, the fasting during the month of Ramadan.
Ramadan, yes.
And we have
the zakat, giving
the charity. And once in your lifetime to go to the first house of worship built that Abraham also
absolutely.
He built.
And that's
the Hajj.
And that's the reason why you should find those people in your local area who can guide you to this. And if you don't know, then they can contact us.
This is very simple. And to avoid the major sins.
Yes, to avoid the major sins.
And I'd like to just mention also one point. If you're still, I'd like to encourage people. There's one, I believe it's a hadith quoting that Allah is saying, all my slaves are misguided, correct? Unless I guide them. So if you're at that crossroads, is to humble yourself and to put your forehead on the ground, just like Jesus did, didn't he?
Yes.
He prayed.
He fell on his face.
He fell on his face and prayed to God. Fall on your face and pray to God. Ask him to guide you. And then from there, earnestly seek God's blessings, His guidance, and then from there, take the necessary steps.
Absolutely.
Okay, we'd like to thank you for tuning in. This week on The Dean Show, Joshua Evans, tune in. We're going to have the true gospel of Jesus, and we're going to talk about some other things, some other shows for you. Thank you for tuning in. Thank you for bringing us this week, brother.
Absolutely, anytime. It's a pleasure.
Thank you. Jazakallah khairan. Thank you, and we'll see you on The Dean Show. Assalamu alaikum. Peace be unto you.